Greetings and welcome to The Thirsty Mage, the podcast that would definitely trade in their law degrees to be Kamurocho private detectives. On this week's show, we're investigating our way through the world of Studio RGG's Judgment, which shares its setting with the Yakuza games. I'm your host for this episode, Jordan Rudek, and I'm still upset that the game's Japanese name, Judge Eyes, ended up switching to something much more pedestrian for its Western release. But, c'est la vie. Joining me this evening is an individual who's still putting the pieces together of how this game even ended up on his Xbox, and that's David Lloyd.
I was definitely tricked by the Android app into believing that I had already purchased the game, only to find out that there's like some kind of special program where you can preload games without purchasing them, but you can only do it through the Android app, which is really weird. I don't know why that's the case. But yeah, I was definitely tricked into buying this. Microsoft got my money. I probably would have got this on the PS5, but at the end of the day, it didn't really matter. It probably feels or plays exactly the same way, but it's more the principle of being tricked.
It sounds like entrapment, like one of the side quests from Judgment. You know, like you've been set up by somebody, and they ended up getting they got your funds no matter what. It sounds like a pretty devious but also clever tactic, I guess, to get people to spend money on Xbox. But
nothing wrong with the program. Like, I think it's kind of neat that you can download a game without paying for it, because maybe you want to. I know for me, it would take like these big games take a long time to download on my slow internet. So it's kind of nice to have that option. But it's more there's no indicator that would make it. All it says is download to your console.
Right.
So I'm like, oh, okay, I guess I own it, you know?
And when you see that on Switch or PS5, the indication is that you've already paid for it or you got it free somehow, right? So,
yeah. So, yeah, that's on me. So,
again, you were going to buy it anyway. So, hopefully, you didn't have to pay too much more on Xbox, but
no.
Also dancing in the streets of Kamurocho with us is a budding detective in her own right, and that's Paige Chamberlain.
So, why am I a detective?
I don't know. You were a detective because you found out you started the game like 3 years ago or something like that. And finally got back to it, I guess. Thank you.
Okay, to David, that apparently I heard that the PS5 port, like, some people don't like the lighting or something.
Oh,
yeah, like something about that.
Where are you playing it? Where are you playing it, Paige? Or where did you play it?
I got it on PS4.
Okay.
And I owned that. Back in 2019, I played a bit. I apparently somehow didn't save after finishing the first chapter, which, having done it again, I don't understand, because there's a prompt to save immediately after the cutscenes are over. So I don't know how that happened. And then I transferred the saves to my PS5. And it's really funny seeing, because you can buy the PS4 version and the PS5 on the store, and it's like the price difference. And then you can't get some of the DLC for the PS4 version anymore, and I think the PS5 must come with it or something, because it's not listed for that version at all.
That's weird. I bought the PS5 native version, and it came with a bunch of like additional like power-ups and items and stuff like that, and which kind of made parts of the games a breeze. Actually, I was really happy to have them, like these special orbs that I guess you would craft normally to give you like the ability to shoot fireballs and summon lightning from the sky. It was kind of funny, like it was almost like fantasy RPG type skills I was doing.
The Dance of Life?
Yeah, the Dance of Life, that's right. Yeah. Those were just fun. They were fun to have when I was kind of getting sick of the combat, which does happen to me when I play these games. So nice to have that extra content. But Paige, you mentioned a lighting issue on PS5. I didn't notice anything. I mean, I'm not super sensitive to visual things all that much, so maybe there is and I just didn't see it. But yeah, it didn't bother me, at least. Now, I was curious how much. I know David and I finished the game. Paige, you said you got to just a couple chapters into the game. Is that right?
Yes, I finished chapter 2.
Where's just so we don't do too much, story spoiling or talking too much about it. Where what's happening in the story where you're at right now?
I think it's Hummer is very mad and trying to. The guy that you got off the hook in the trial is mad because you're looking into who the actual murderer is, and he tried to get you beat up. You had to escape on a skateboard,
as you do.
Yeah.
You think he'd be a little more grateful after getting him off the hook, but no, he's right back at your throat. Yeah, like a true Yakuza, you know, he's going to keep holding a grudge or something like that. Before we get into the game proper, I wanted to do, so now that we kind of know where we're at, we don't need to, you know, do too much story talk, although I know David and I really did like the story.
Other than maybe, I guess, mentioning the setup of it.
Yeah. Why don't we?
His backstory was that he's a former Yakuza. Then he goes and gets, or he's associated with the Yakuza or something.
Yeah, I was gonna say sort of. I don't think he was ever actually a Yakuza, but he definitely like.
He was close to.
Adopted. He was adopted by like the head of a subsidiary, right? It's a subsidiary of the Tojo Clan. The Tojo Clan, you know, being part of the Yakuza game, so you'd be familiar with some of the names of the Yakuza groups that come up here. So Yagami, the main character, he's a lawyer, former lawyer, who becomes kind of a private detective, has his own shop set up. But he is very, very related to the Yakuza. They all know him, right? Because he was kind of under their wing for a little while.
Because his whole thing was when he was a lawyer, he got a murderer off a murder case. And in Japan, the law system's pretty, like, it's 99% conviction rate. So, you know, it's like a really big deal to get someone off the hook. But then turns out that guy was not good. So I think that's what left him to leave being a lawyer and become a detective instead. And then this story is about him trying to find, you know, a real killer after, you know, again, he's sort of, trying to make amends in a way.
He kind of takes on like piecemeal cases for the old law firm where he used to work, right? So he's kind of like, he's still friends with them and he'll take on like private detective work if they have it. It's funny, like, Paige and I, a couple weeks ago, we talked about visual novels and coming off of playing Phoenix Wright, where you are a lawyer and, you know, you're doing investigating, and then to go into playing or talking about a game like Judgment was kind of a funny, just looking at the same thing from two very, very different perspectives. Speaking of different perspectives, just kind of before we get too much into the game, I wanted to just talk briefly about the split between the Yakuza games and Judgment, because they do take place in the same universe or same world, right? Especially this very familiar setting of Kamurocho. I don't think you see any of the main characters pop up in the game. I may have forgotten about it, but I don't think there's any cameos or anything like that. So it's really just the setting, right? It's the setting and the kind of the shops and even the way the combat and progression, all those things work. Very familiar to anyone who's played any of the original six Yakuza games or the spinoffs. But what's kind of happened is starting with Yakuza 7, Like a Dragon, which we talked about, last year with the protagonist Ichiban, that was a turn-based RPG, right? So it was a big departure for them to go to turn-based for the Yakuza games, starting with Like a Dragon. And then before that, you had Judgment and then its sequel, Lost Judgment, which are the action games of old, like the games, like the Yakuza games that start Kiryu. It seems like that split is going to continue. I know that the Studio RGG team lost one of their lead developers, Toshihiro Nagoshi.
He went to Tencent.
That's right. Yeah. So I don't know. I'm not sure what he's doing there. Like maybe similar types of games for Tencent, but I don't know that we have an update on what he's working on right now.
Well, he was the godfather
of these Monkey Ball style games.
That's right. More Monkey Ball. More Yakuza with Monkey Ball, like a genuine like mix up of the two. You're right, David. Like he was the, you know, kind of overseeing all of this, right? And there's a lot of games kind of under his watch that have been quite good, I think, especially like Yakuza Zero, the Kiwami games. And then I think Like a Dragon was one of the last games that he worked on, maybe?
I think so. It's funny. Then, people should look up the pictures of him, though. Like, look up a picture of him when he did an early, like before Yakuza, and then look at a picture of him now. Yeah. And you would never believe it's the same guy. Like, it's hilarious.
Like, he looks like a character from one of the games.
He does. Right? He looks like a Yakuza now, like the way he dresses and hair and everything. Like back when he first started, he kind of looked like your generic Japanese developer, like a guy who sits behind a computer all day. And Ito looks totally different now. It's hilarious.
Yeah. It's funny that, you know, he maybe really bought into the writing that he's doing, right? Like, like a character actor, or like someone might do before they take on a role where they try to like live that role. I don't know that he lived as a Yakuza or something like that.
I heard he did talk, like he did have like interviews with the actual Yakuza and stuff.
It makes sense. Cause I mean, these games really do feel authentic. Like, not that I've lived in Japan or know too much about Yakuza, but it does make me feel like I'm kind of living that life playing.
Reminds
these games
of your BC gang life.
Tons of that stuff happening out here, right? But that's what we need a Yakuza game set in Canada at some point, right? But at any rate, yeah, so we've got this split between the new Yakuza games. We know another Like a Dragon game is coming. There's going to be at least one more games with Ichiban as the protagonist. Lost Judgment, the sequel to Judgment, which I think we'll probably take on either later this year or next year or something. I definitely want to play that after finishing this one. I don't know if there's going to be more after Lost Judgment, because there was kind of a... There was a situation with the voice actor who, or the actor whose I think his likeness is based, or Yagami is based on. I think there was something with he got caught with drugs or something like that, which is very, very serious in Japan.
I think it was a different character, but yeah, it was someone who's like a really big celebrity in Japan, and it was a big deal because in Japan drugs are very illegal, and you lose your like entire social standing and career if you're caught with them, which is why in comparison, like from like these games to GTA, that you know they might vaguely reference some things, but you don't really see the use in the games or something.
I think there was a dust up too. Like, there was definitely the celebrity, I think it was cocaine or something they got caught with.
Yeah.
But then I also think there was some kind of dust up with the voice, because the voice actor thing sounds familiar to me. I think there was something about this, either the voice actors wanted the game on Steam or Sega wanted the game on Steam, and his
agency was like, no.
Yeah.
Right. Yes.
So there was some like bad blood there, because there's something to do with putting the game on Steam, and yeah, the talent agency is like, no, you can't put it there. So I don't know if that's affects like sequel as well.
The guy that was originally playing as Hamura, so his likeness was based, you know, on the voice actor. That was the one that had to get replaced.
Okay. It's almost fitting that there's this controversy around these games, given that they deal in such a sordid sort of material and thing, you know, underhanded underworld things that are happening in these games. It's almost kind of ironic that there's also now like, you know, controversy of this drug use in real life that is affecting development or production of the games and things like that. So yeah, just kind of interesting to see, you know, I'm not sure what the future holds for both of the series. I'd love to see more. I am excited for the inevitable announcement of Like a Dragon 2 or whatever they're going to call it, and eventually playing Lost Judgment. And I hope that things get resolved to the point where we can see more of these games, because they've been putting them out at a pretty good clip too. You know, it's every year and a half, it feels like we're getting a new one in one of the two series, right?
Yeah, you can always have sports game, you can always have Atelier games, you can always have Yakuza game.
Yeah,
pretty much. And I mean, they're kind of using similar scenario or similar settings and similar mechanics. Obviously the turn-based one was a big departure, but like there's still so much in that game that feels like the same DNA they've been working with. So it did feel quite familiar anyway. So I'm interested to see what they're going to do more. Obviously Judgment was a little bit more serious than the Yakuza games, it felt like, but we'll get into that more in a little bit. Why don't we start with impressions, kind of like, Not full reviews, obviously, but you know, David, how did you like the game? You finished it all the way through. Give you know, how long did you spend with it, and where did you end up by the end?
Yeah, so I really enjoyed it. I think I ended up being, it was like 19 or 20 hours by the time I finished it. I pretty much just mainlined the story. I didn't go off the beaten path too much. I did a couple of the mini games just to see what they were like, but nothing really jumped out at me. Like, there's so many little things that it's like, yeah, it's, you know, I played Virtua Fighter, I think, in on an arcade somewhere. I did the baseball game, which I think is in like every Yakuza game. I did the drone, a drone race. There's this weird like virtual reality board game thing that's going on. I did one of those, I was like, this is weird. I'm okay. Because it was mostly just like rolling a dice and then fighting people. And like the fighting was definitely the least favorite part for me. But I think the best way to enjoy this game, or at least for me it was, is to kind of treat it as a visual novel more than like a fully acted visual novel to a certain degree. Like, you know, there's so many cinema scenes where it's almost like watching a, you know, 18-hour movie with like an hour of fighting in between.
I was gonna say, this game was the first one in a long time that had English voice acting, didn't it?
Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
There was like, I think they might have tried it with the early games and then just gone, nah. And
Well, and I think the other thing about this too is that the cast was, I thought the cast was fantastic. Like, there's, you know, I have a hard time with the, you know, English names, but I remember all the characters' names in this game. I might not pronounce them properly when I, you know, recite them back, but I actually remember, like, when I see someone, I know who they are. Like, it's, you know, they're all, I don't think there was any really weak links in the game. Like, everyone had a little part to play. And I think Yagami was a terrific protagonist. Like, it's one of those where he's like, he's clearly like a good guy, but also not perfect. Like, made mistakes, but keeps fighting through. Like, I just thought there was a lot of complexity and layers to the story. And they did a good job of a detective story, like just how everything grew and built and unveiled as the game went on. And by skipping all the side stuff, I felt like it was very well paced, where you're always getting like some new information that made it fun and entertaining, and never got bored right up to the end, and with the big really nice finale.
It does that thing of when you solve one thing, or you feel like you've solved the crime, or you've solved the mystery, another mystery shows up, right? And so it does a really good job of always feeling like there's something left unresolved, or there's something more to discover. You never have that feeling too long of being, we've wrapped everything up in a nice little bow. You know, it kind of keeps you on your toes, keeps you on the edge of your seat for, especially almost all of the second half of the game, I would say, for sure. Paige, what about you? What are your kind of impressions so far? Like, what do you like, not like about the game? What are you into?
I'm pretty sure I heard David say that he's not good with English names, and we know that's true. So.
Let alone Japanese names, yeah.
I think I must have got it on launch or something. Played a little bit, not entirely sure why I put it down, to be honest, but I definitely did enjoy what I was doing in the original bit, because I went around, went to all the shops, made some friends, wanted to buy, like, had lots of food in my inventory, needed to get into fights to actually be able to eat it. I had fun with, I guess I went to one of the Club Segas, which, rest in peace.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah, it's funny.
They live on in games like this now, right?
But I got all my Monkey Ball characters from the claw machine and put them in my office. I played Fighting Vipers, which is something I'd never heard of before. And it's a really cool, like, little fighting game where they've got like an armor system. So you like knock off parts of their like clothes and stuff as well. It's not just beating them through the fence wall and stuff. So I had a lot of fun with like that side activities. I do remember getting very frustrated at one of, because like the gameplay, you've got this mix of like the beat 'em up content, you've got these investigation segments, you've got like quite a few different things to do throughout the main story repeatedly. I got really annoyed at one of the investigation things because I couldn't figure out where the cat in the alleyway was, and it keeps meowing until you find it.
Yes, that's right.
So yeah. I was very annoyed at that. But yeah, then I picked it up again. I apparently didn't save after I don't know how I didn't save it. And I'm like, oh no, I have to do this hard bit where I'm in a building and I beat up all these guys. And I don't know how I thought it was hard. Maybe I just didn't know that I could pause and eat food or something. Because I just looked up, it's the triangle and the square. That's the buttons. Basically just mash triangle so you spin kick into everyone. Mm-hmm. So far, the only issue of like the... I guess my main issue with the combat is that the street guys are so easy, so it's hard to get practice for people, like characters that actually fight good. And my thing is I just need to learn to avoid attacks, and I can't seem to get the wall jumping to work at all. Like,
yeah, you really, like, you really do. The world jumping is really strong.
I don't know if you can do that outside of combat, because I was trying to, like, practice to try and see, but I don't think it lets, yeah.
No, I don't think so. I think it's only in
combat, yeah.
One aspect I do not like at all, and this is why I didn't play a tiny bit more, is the tailing missions, where you have to follow somebody and be close enough but far enough, and they turn around and stop and take pictures of stuff, and you go try and get to the next hiding space without getting too close to them, or they're going to see you. I really don't like those at all. I hate that, like, mm-hmm. stuff in games, and obviously this is all this extra stuff is because you're a detective, so you've got to do all this, these things a lot. I'm like, I really hate those. I do, however, like the chase sequences, which is basically running plus some quick time events. So I like those. I would prefer the chase segments over the tailing segments by a lot. And yeah, so it's, there's some aspects of the main gameplay that make me kind of like go, I don't know if I want to keep playing it. And I keep, but I definitely like the combat. I really like the main, like, I like Yagami and Kaito a lot. So it's just like, you know, I've just got to dredge past these gameplay segments that I don't like, because they're going to keep coming up repeatedly to get to the good stuff.
Yeah, I think Yagami and Kaito-san are a great pair. Like, I think they play off each other really well. Like, the voice actors, I think I think they're written well. You really do kind of feel like their relationship grows as the game goes on. You know, they're kind of playful with each other, but you can see, like, that trust that's building up with them. Obviously, they've been friends, they've been close for a long time, but I don't know that they've worked together in this capacity for all that long. So they get better at kind of being a team, being partners for one another. Paige, I share your, you know, dislike of the tailing segments, and that's one of the reasons I didn't do a lot of the side stories in this game, because I think a lot of them do involve like a tailing component, and it's a shame, because I think the turn to a detective type of story works well, but it's some of the kind of gameplay components that come with it that don't work as well, like the tailing missions that are just super slow, the ones where you have to take, like, photographs and stuff at the end. Like, it's fine, but it's just like, it's all very slow, and then the photo part goes really fast.
The photo bit where it's like, oh, you can only, like, take one shot. It's like, why?
It's weird. It goes so fast.
I have a digital camera. Why can't I just keep taking shots till I get the?
And come on, if it were a real private detective, you know they're taking, like, 100 photos, right, to try to get, like, the best angle. Like, it's not just one shot and you're done kind of thing. I think the chasing is fine, too. I mean, some of them went a little long, and, you know, some of the... They were a nice little change of pace. And at least you're going fast there. They didn't last that long, as opposed to some of the tailing sequences. I thought some of the lock picking stuff was very, and like choosing your key to get in a door was just kind of silly. I don't know why you got to choose the key to get in. It's just weird. Just open a door. You've got the keys. Like, why do you have to choose the right one?
There's a skill that you can buy that just tells you what the key is.
And that was one of the first ones I bought, because I didn't want to deal with it. Like, especially later, you get like 10 keys. Like,
oh, you can just check inventory for what they are too. Yeah. But yeah, I liked buying the skills. I definitely got one that, so if I smash anything up in the shop, it doesn't ruin my reputation with the shopkeeper.
Yep, I got that one too. Yeah.
Because I even almost immediately, like, accidentally, like, just because he's a very clumsy walker. Like, he just knocks a bunch of stuff over just by walking into it, or if he's sprinting, he's just smacking into the wall. It's really.
I think guys can kick you into a store. They can literally, like, kick you through the window of a store, and you have no choice. Like, you didn't even try to do anything. It was someone else, right? But
And I think I used a bunch of points on alcohol, like, boosting certain things. And then I go and grab my free drinks, and then go, and then I'm like six drinks in, like, ooh.
You mentioned Club Sega, Paige. I love that these games, because they're all, you know, owned by Sega. Sega has no problem throwing classic Sega games into them so that you can play them. It reminds me a little bit of Animal Crossing on the GameCube, where you could buy, like, old NES games. Yeah. Obviously, they don't do that anymore, but you can find games. You mentioned what was it? Something Vipers, Striking Vipers, something like that. Yeah,
Fighting Vipers.
Fighting Vipers. There's Virtua Fighter here as well. Motor Raid, Space Harrier is a kind of classic one. It's been in a bunch of Sega games. Puyo Puyo and Fantasy Zone. I love Fantasy Zone. So I didn't spend too much time playing through the arcade games. One of them is actually in Yagami's office as well. I think that one works, unless pinball. I'm thinking of it. Yeah, just pinball one, right? Yeah. But yeah, then you go, there's a Club Sega right outside where you can always go and visit. But other than that, the mini games I think are just fine. There's standard like kind of card ones like poker and blackjack at the casino. It's funny that the casino is located like underground, like where a fishing shop is, like a little like fishing place where people go and fish for like koi or something. I don't know. It's just a funny location for it.
You can run in the pond too. Like you can just walk it through. That's the pond, right. And flash around. It's pretty funny.
I think I was disappointed that it doesn't look like I can actually do fishing there. And I was like, oh
no.
Which is surprising because there are cutscenes where you are fishing or you see people fishing there and having a conversation, but you can't actually do the fishing yourself.
I don't know. There's a lot of like the gambling, mahjong stuff, like shoji stuff.
Yep.
You said the baseball, and I think the main other thing was the drone racing.
Yeah, the drone racing is not bad actually. Like it's kind of fun. And then you can get parts or you can craft parts for your drones to improve them. There's like four or five different tournaments you can enter. I had some fun doing that, but I kind of just stuck to the mini games that were kind of along the main quests, sort of. Like if you're doing the main quest and then you kind of come across one that like, oh, why don't you try this? And then I would probably try it once. David, you mentioned like the virtual kind of board game one. It's an interesting one too. What can you remind me what happens in that one?
So he puts a what do you call the VR headset on or whatever, it goes into this like board game style view of Kamurocho, and then you have to get from like point A to point B, but you only get so many dice rolls.
Yes, that's right.
And depending, so you roll the dice and it'll be like four. So then you go four squares and then there's something that happens on the square. Like it could be that you have to do there's an action where it like puts you into a little arena where you have to battle and beat the people to move on, or it's like roll again or it's stuff like that. But it's basically like the whole point is you're supposed to be getting to the very end. And I mean, some of it's luck based. Because if you're rolling low numbers, like you're screwed. Like I think I rolled like twos and threes and I couldn't get to the end. And there's like different paths that you can take as well, depending on like there's a shorter path there, but I think it might have like more fighting squares or something, and then a longer path. And so there's like some risk and reward there.
It reminds me a little bit of the Dragon Quest minigames, the Treasures and Trapdoors or TNT minigames, where it's very much like the same thing. Like you use the ticket to go and play the board game, and you're just kind of moving around. And if you get to the end, you get a prize. But along the way, that you can earn items, or you can fight battles, and I think you get experience or gold from those. Or you might step on a square that moves you back three, and so it's harder to get to the end. This one kind of seemed like a simplified version of that in a way, even though that one's pretty rudimentary too. But I thought it was fun enough, and kind of a not something we'd really seen from a Yakuza game before, so for that reason I didn't mind it.
So yeah, some of the site, like I guess they normally don't have a ton of side activities, but it did seem that maybe just the ones you had were just the really basic ones, aside from like I guess the drone racing was new. Even I didn't really play very much of it, but you know, say before that was Yakuza 6, and yeah, that had the karaoke. There was adult chat rooms, and apparently there was spearfishing. I definitely didn't get up to that, but you know, like there was more variety in the kind of things you could do.
Yeah, it does feel like even in Like a Dragon, they had like a I guess similar to the drone racing, they had like a Mario Kart type mini game, but that one even had like power ups and stuff. They had the David, you'll remember the trash or the can collecting mini game from Like a Dragon, right? Yeah. Like that was pretty fun. Like they felt more creative in that one, but maybe also like a Dragon and some of the Yakuza games, like they're a little more lighthearted than this one. You know, this one did play a little more seriously, and so the mini games maybe felt a little bit like that too, a little darker, a little more serious in tone, and not so kind of silly or slice of life-ish, I guess. it's funny. I'm looking at the notes, and we're kind of going like reverse order from what I laid out, and that's fine. But why don't we go back to the combat for a second? I know for me personally, like I prefer the turn based as well. I think the action is fine, but I'm not great at it. I don't learn how to block or avoid attacks, or I forget how to do that halfway through. In this game, in Judgment, I was happy to have like a lot of kind of basically press X and win type items, and cheats. I would use them regularly. Like they pretty much are just cheats. So I would use these essence items that I got for, I guess as DLC or whatever. And I would just kind of turn those on during a boss battle, or I would fight it once, and if it wasn't going well, I'd use some health restoring items and then turn on a cheat code basically and just win it that way. And that's fine. Like not kind of cheesing the combat didn't reduce how much I was enjoying the game. So I think it's really the story that shines through here as, being the focal point for sure. And at least the thing that I was getting the most out of. I prefer the turn-based combat of Like a Dragon. I hope, that's why I'm really looking forward to the next one. I would obviously keep playing more Judgment games, but just not typically playing them for the combat. I'm just a turn-based fiend. Like, what can I say? David, how about you?
Yeah, like I didn't mind the action. Like when I compared to Like a Dragon, the action was nice in the sense where, because I'm so focused on the story, like you could get into a fight and it lasts like 5 seconds and then you just keep going. So I didn't mind that so much because a lot of the fights were pretty quick. And yeah, those essence that you can use to either like, you can create a bomb that like blows everyone off the floor, or you can make your hands like electric so that they shock people, like getting through that stuff. Like to me, that's great. Cause like you said, you do a few fights, you're satisfied. Let's just see more story. The thing that irritated me most about the combat though, was the mortal wounds. So they have this system in place where like, so you have your health bar at the top, but if Yagami gets hit with certain weapons or certain attacks, He takes a mortal wound, it's called, and there's a permanent loss of your health bar until you see a doctor. And it was very irritating because there's so many times where you'll just run into multiple people. Yeah, the med kits are expensive though. They're like,
and they're not that common. It's hard to find them. Maybe you get them as rewards for doing side stories and stuff. But
yeah,
it's frustrating. You have to go to the doctor. Like there's a doctor underground in the sewers.
Yeah.
Who can also heal you or sell you the med kits. But you're right, they're not cheap. They're not cheap. Well,
and then the doctor is like the furthest away on the map. It's like the top, furthest northwest that you can go. Like it's absolutely.
And there's only one of him and one way to get there. Yeah. Like
And it seems like after any kind of major fight, like it's like, okay, well I'm off to the doctor again. I can't continue because I've lost 75% of my health. Like it's nuts.
Almost everyone in the back half has a sword or a knife or a gun, and those are dealing those grievous wounds to you like every time, right? So you can't even avoid it, really.
Yeah, and there's one in particular. What I think it's like 80% of the way through. I won't spoil what it is necessarily, but there comes a point where it's like, okay, you come through the front door of the lobby or whatever, and you got to go 8 floors up, and so there's every floor has like a. Okay, there's like 6 or 7 guys you got to fight, and then there's a boss. And you do that for like 7 floors, and the boss has a different weapon every time.
Yes,
and
I know.
And like by the time I got to the top, I had like there was nothing left. I had no, like there was barely any health left whatsoever. And so you have to beat this boss with like 25% of your health, like the final boss at the top. And it was the most irritating fight of all of them. And especially when you're trying to fight a boss with a weapon too, like it's just, and they have there's like 2 or 3 phases of health where it's like, okay, you get the bar down and then they pull out some other like weapon or something. And then you got to take them down again. And it's like, even the final boss was not nearly as difficult as this particular gauntlet of this building. It was insane.
Yeah, what about you, Paige? How do you feel about the combat? Even maybe a little bit of the progression as well. I know we talked a little bit about leveling up and stuff, but did you mess around with leveling up any of the combat stuff too?
Yeah, so like I said, like I was trying to figure out how to do the wall jumping because I upgraded some, like add some different moves I could do after wall jumping. Yeah, I'm not sure Yeah, because you've got the crane style, which is like the, you know, you just mash triangle and then on the third one you'll do a big spinny kick and knock three guys over. I don't know how well I was really struggling. Like I said, I just got to figure, you know, I've just got to use my block and the evasion is a different, like a completely, like, you know, different bun set. So I've got to do basically just try not to get hit a bit more because usually I can, like, wail on them for a fair bit, but sometimes they get me. I did get a skill, though, if I've got, like, enough EX, so when they knock you down and you're trying to, like, mash X to get back up, if they come near me, I have a skill to just, like, knock them out or nearly or do a bunch of damage. So I know I did that about three times on this one tough guy that I fought. I like the combat. I've just got to, yeah, I'm just, there's certain aspects where I'm trying to get used to it and I feel like I don't really have anywhere good to practice it because the street guys are too weak.
they go down too fast, right? Like their health bars are quite slight and I think that persists for a lot of the game too. Yeah, they kind of just stay easy to beat, and they don't. But another thing just kind of jumped to my mind is that you don't often get money from fighting the kind of random guys. So I usually just run past them because you don't get a lot of experience or money from fighting them, which was a little bit frustrating.
I actually with the, you know, because you could buy food for health and stuff, and I got almost annoyed because I wanted to try all the different food, but I'd have to actually have taken. You know, I need to run into a fight and take some hits or something because it's like, oh, you're a fool, you can't eat this. And I'm like, but I wanted to try it.
There's, that happened to me too, which was unfortunate. There's one fellow you can be friends with. And if you, mm-hmm. if you make friends with him, you can open up this perk in the skill tree that lets you keep eating though you're full. So you need to buy that one page and then you can eat to your heart's delight like a buffet.
I want to load up on drinks at the free drinks at the casino and see how drunk you can
there
get.
There you go, exactly. Yeah.
You know, that even counts for your health, so I can't, you know, have too much.
I like how the game I think we're, you know, kind of on a similar wavelength with the combat. I was thinking about some of the areas of the game, like, because it takes you to the same places pretty often, right? You go to Yagmi's office pretty often. You go to the lawyer office where he used to work and see his friends there, get missions from them. They obviously play a big role in the story. You kind of keep in touch with them regularly. But you also keep going back to like the places like the casino or this underground arcade as well that's run by one of the. Or at least kind of partial. Yeah, he's great too, right? Like,
by Higashi.
He's one of the Yakuza from the clan that you were kind of raised by. And he, I don't know if he runs the arcade per se, but he's definitely, it's like a hideout for him, I guess, you know? Yeah.
Well, it's funny because so Kaito apparently used to be in charge of it. It's basically a front for their money laundering.
Yes.
So one of them has to be there.
Yeah,
but they don't do anything. Like every time you go to the arcade, Higashi's just in the back smoking.
Yes, that's right.
Like he's not doing anything, but he has to be there. Because
doesn't look like he's working at all. Like he's literally just like a figurehead or something. You know, he's got that one employee who stands out in front, and I guess he's like doing any actual work of the arcade. And then there's there's just one kid as part of a side quest or a main quest that goes there. Wants like one of the toys, wants one of the prizes or something like that. And then, there's no other customers that go in there.
I guess Higashi would have had to have like replaced all the things. Cause every time I go down there and I get into a fight, I destroy the entire place.
Yes,
like,
yes,
on,
yes,
on purpose too. I'm like, oh, there's still an arcade up here. Well, I'm going to kick this over.
There's actually no room there to fight at all. Like it's inevitable that you're going to just knock down all the cabs there, right? So,
and I think there's at least three fights in there. Like there's a few.
Yeah, for sure. But I like returning to the same places like that. I think it's fun. Like it makes them kind of feel a little bit more intimate. Like the places feel like meaningful. Like you go there for like sit down chats sometimes too. And like, you know, people are like lighting up cigarettes and you're kind of just sitting and it becomes like a little bit of like a home base for you too. Right. Where, all of the kind of members of your group, like the allies that you meet and Higashi, like all these people that, you know, that kind of befriend, they all meet up there and it's just a place to kind of hang out and chill. Or yeah, like there's definitely some big battles that you throw down there pretty often too. So I just like that about the game that you go to these places and more than once and it makes them feel like meaningful areas. I mean, they just, it kind of adds or breathes life into them a little bit. unlike maybe in some other, you know, games of this style where you go to a place once and then you never go back and it's like, oh, this was a cool place. How come we didn't make use of it a little bit more? So I did like that aspect of the game too.
Yeah, KG art, yeah, you end up going back to several times, and it's the reception that you get depending on the time of the game is different, which is kind of funny.
Yeah, that's right. Including like, you know, you go in as wearing a disguise, or you go in with your drone, kind of taking photos of people inside the building and stuff like that. How did we feel about kind of thing, like, I guess those parts of the missions where you're flying the drone around, taking pictures or exploring or looking to see what's happening? Any thoughts about that?
They were fine. My only thing is that there seemed to be no, I know you got a little bit of SP if you did certain things in a certain way, but there never seemed to be any, what's the word? Like there's no disincentive. Like, you were getting past it.
Yes.
So there were no risks or whatever. Like it was just a thing to do.
Just how long is it going to take you to do it? Yeah, but you know, whether you know, a minute or 10 minutes, you still have to go through it. Right.
Yeah. So in that sense, there was a few of them where it's like, yeah, like there's an early lawyer, like when I think it's chapter 2 or 3, where you're in the court, and I'm a little worried because I think I might be blowing this for like a different later in the game, but there are some courtroom things where you have to choose certain responses, and early on I made a mistake and it just kept on going like nothing happened. And I was like, oh, I think it would have been a little bit cooler if it was like, well, you screwed this up. You got to do it again. And there was no real, I guess it's funny that you had mentioned Phoenix Wright, because I think it would have been neat if they had set up the courtroom battles like Phoenix Wright, where you had figure out how to win the case, and you could actually lose the case and get a game over. Like that would have been.
You're not a lawyer anymore.
I know, but it still would have been fun.
I think the courts in this are a bit more realistic than
Yeah, definitely a lot more serious here than the circus that Phoenix takes part in. What about visiting Cumbershaw? Like we've all played games that have been set in here before. Did it feel different? Did it feel new? Did it feel old? Like how did we go about exploring this maybe familiar area?
I don't think I've ever played quite enough of the games to actually, you know, get it like the back of my hand or anything. I've always like just tried a little bit, not gotten far. I always get annoyed when I run at the edge of the town and I'm like, oh, I can't even walk around the side.
I want to go further.
And I'm like, let me just like walk around. So sometimes I just catch the taxi so I don't have to. I don't mind them reusing it because, like, you know, when games are like basically annual, that tends to happen with things getting redone.
For sure.
And, yeah, so it's understandable, although I think, well, I know in some other games sometimes they've gone elsewhere. And I don't know whether they, you know, needed to set this one in the same exact area, especially because, like, it's, I mean, depends what year the other ones are set, but it's like, you know, you don't run into characters from the other games and stuff, so... Why is there a need to be in the same place as them? Like, I guess they just wanted to use some of the same family, like, you know, like divisions of some of the named families and stuff. And again, like use the assets, but like they could have probably gone elsewhere too.
Yeah, I mean, I guess again, gonna keep kind of relating it to like a dragon, which is a different setting, right? Like that's Yokohama, and it was nice to go to somewhere new and kind of, you know, play around this area. And it, parts of it look the same for sure, but this Kamurocho, you know, after playing like 3 or 4 games here, like, you know, you just know certain street corners, you know, like what things look like, where things are expected to be. And it did feel a little over familiar. And I think part of the reason why I didn't do a ton of the side stuff was the main game already has you kind of doing a lot of backtracking and going to point A, point B, and then back to point A. And for that reason, like I'm already seeing so much of the same stuff that has become maybe a little bit over familiar that I just don't want to spend too much more extra time than the main stories are going to take me. So if the main, if I can do the main story in 20, 25 hours, that's enough time for me spent going back to a world like this. I don't need to play 40, 50 hours and do a ton of the side stories. Even if some of them are interesting, I don't want any more back and forth. And then, you know, like we mentioned, the idea of like the trailing mini game, just not being super fun, because I think so much of the side stories are built around some of those not super fun new mechanics. Another reason I was going to disincentivize to explore too much more. But I'm fine. Like I'm fine to keep going back to this place, but I just don't know how much extra time I'm going to put in outside of what the main story chapters are asking me to do. David, what about you?
Yeah, I don't mind when they reuse assets, like. But it would be nice if they kind of built upon it. I think of like Legends of Heroes uses here's my Legends of Heroes.
We got it. Yeah.
When you think of like Trails of Cold Steel 3, like there was a bunch of different places, and then Cold Steel 4, the same places were still there. They reused the assets, but then they added a few more locations. Like I think that's pretty good, especially for games franchises that I'm really into. It's nice that like. Obviously the games are going to come out quicker if they can reuse assets and not have to rebuild an entire environment. I even think of like the Crossbell arc, that games that are coming out, shortly here in a few months where, yeah, like both games are based in Crossbell, but then there's like outside areas they go to that gets added in and stuff. So I don't mind it. I guess the thing is I guess it would have been nice if the places in Judgment, like, there are a few places that you go to that are outside Camarocho that you have to use like a taxi to get to, but I don't think you really got an opportunity to explore those places. Like I'm thinking of like the ADDC, you know, that you go there for reasons, I guess I'll just say for now. And it's a huge place, but you don't really have a much of an opportunity to look around. Like there's not much to look at either. So I guess maybe it would be nice if it's like, okay, well, we're going to send you to this place. Like I think of, like there's a restaurant you go to, that you need a taxi for later in the game. And really like, it's just like one arena when you get there, like there's cinema scene and then it's like, okay, now you get to fight. And then when you're done, you just leave. And it's like, oh, well, you know, it's nice that Camarocho is there. It gives you that familiarity. I still didn't really feel like I was always looking at the map still. Like I was always like, oh, okay, where should, you know, looking at the mini map and being like, okay, I got to go northeast or southeast or whatever. So I just kind of run the streets, keep my eye on the map and stuff. But it's neat to see, like, get an idea of like, this is what Japan kind of looks like. And it feels like you're walking the streets of it. So it's kind of neat that in that sense. So
those few times where they're like, oh, we need to go down Tenkaichi Street, or they would name a street and be like, they wouldn't put it on the map. Like you wouldn't have the indicator of where to go. They're just like, name a street. I'm like, oh crap. Now I gotta figure out where this is. Yeah. Like, cause I just never really pay attention to the names or anything. Like I'd be like, oh, of course this area with this shop. Like I know that. But I wasn't really focusing ever on the names of what things are called. I do love how it always kind of gives you, almost always gives an indicator of where you need to go. I think for the side quests, it doesn't do that as much. Like you kind of have to lay down your own pins of where you need to go next for something. But that's fine. But there's just another thing in terms of the city and then the map and what you're doing. I didn't love the focus on becoming friends with everybody. I felt like that was a little bit kind of heavy-handed. Yeah, I mean, I like when there's
I liked having my buddies and like trying to get the rep. I like games that do that because it makes you feel like you're actually part of the area, like the tiny little neighborhood you're in.
There's just so many of them. Like I wish there were fewer that you were more invested in. Like so fewer of those friend characters that had more of a story arc rather than, just dozens and dozens of them where not a lot happens with them.
A lot of them are money. It's like, if you buy enough from me, I'll be your friend.
Yeah, like it just, I mean, there isn't really a relationship happening there. It seems more like, you know, see numbers and meters go up and then, oh, you're friends again. Or you know, you fill up the reputation in the city and now something else opens up. Like, I just wish it were a little more elegant as opposed to kind of scattershot. It just, it felt like a lot of like little things to do that weren't super rewarding individually.
Supposedly, those friends were supposed, like, they would randomly help you in battle. But I never had anyone.
Happened to me once. And I didn't make too many friends. Maybe that was our problem, David. No, we didn't make friends in the city.
You're not starting enough fights in front of the shops. That's why.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. Yeah. I did see some of the perks you could unlock, or, you know, the ideas of getting help from people. I think I like the idea in principle of you make all these friends in the city, you have a good reputation, so people just help you out in combat. But I think in practice, it doesn't work out as well, maybe. Or maybe you just have to sink so much extra time into the game to see the benefits pay off. But just in terms of the main story, I think you can get there, you know, pretty easily without doing any of that side stuff. So I just wish it were a little more interconnected, maybe. Any final thoughts on the story, or any, you know, anything we, you know, we're hoping to see improved, or maybe even, I don't think any of us have played Lost Judgment yet, or we can do a little bit of, like, you know, speculating about what we would like to see in Lost Judgment, well, and what we think might happen.
I was just looking it up, and I was like, oh, there's the tailing in the second game. Someone's like, only one in the main story, everything else is in side missions, and that, people saying that it's more forgiving, like you don't have to use the dedicated hiding spots as cover, you just, you know, need to be behind stuff. Because that was, like, one problem I found, where it's, aside from, like, everything being short, so you have to go to these hiding spots, it was, you know, other games when you follow someone, you can usually just use the natural environment to hide around, whereas right. when you had to use specific spots, which you wouldn't necessarily know where they are until you're right up next to them. And I know, I think there's a lot more side stuff in the sequel too. To the point that someone, I think some people were annoyed because one of the main big stories was, like, tied behind the high school section. And you had to, like, beat them at some games or something to progress it, but I don't know. Knowing that there's less tailing sequences, it makes me think maybe I can push through the bits I don't like of this game to finish it, so I can play the sequel.
That's definitely a plus if there's less forced side tailing missions, because that was the problem. It's just like you're enjoying the story, you want to see where it goes next, and though it slows to a halt because you're tailing someone for 5 minutes. You know, it's like if there's only one in the main story, I'm fine with that. Because I probably just don't see myself getting super invested in these games doing the side content, because I don't like the combat as much. And I just think the main story is so compelling on its own. And again, I believe the second one is set in Kamurocho as well. So I'm happy to play just another kind of 15, 20 hour game, blaze through the main story, and just enjoy it for what it was. Because I think that's the strongest part of this game. I think the main story is fantastic. I would go so far as to say it might be the best of all the Yakuza and Yakuza adjacent games. I think this is the best story I've experienced. And I loved Yakuza 0 and Like a Dragon. Like, they're top games for me. But this story just knocked it out of the park. And I couldn't believe how just edge of my seat I was for the last 3 or 4 hours, last chapter or two. It was just fantastic. So, Paige, I strongly recommend you go through the game if you can find the time to kind of get through some of the maybe more middling and tailing sections that we don't love. Because I think the story is totally worth it.
I think when you're not doing the side content, the chapters themselves aren't necessarily that long. So it's kind of like you could even piece it off like that. Like, they even do recaps, so, you know, you can just save at the end of the chapter and come back to it later.
Yeah, I think there's 13 or 14 chapters or something in total, and yeah, they're pretty manageable. Some are a little bit longer than others, but yeah, they do feel, you know, yeah, manageable enough. You can get through them, you save at the end, you feel like you accomplished something substantial during your play session usually. So
I liked at the end, again, I'm not going to give spoilers away, but there comes a point at the very end where the game actually tells you, okay, we're in the final, like, this is the final run to the big finale. If it's late, you might want to save and go to bed and come back tomorrow.
Yeah, that's right.
It was exactly what it was like 12:30, and I get to this point and I'm like, oh, okay, well, I guess there's like an hour or two here. Which is funny too, because there was an opportunity to save during that period, but but it would have been tough to walk away from the story because because of the way it finishes.
You got to see what's happening next.
Yeah, I was appreciative that they gave me that opportunity to be like, oh, okay, I'll come back tomorrow when I got more time so I can savor the ending.
There's a few times like that where I think Yagami, like, it's not the end of a chapter, but he's tired and he needs to go to bed. And it's like maybe the middle of one of the longer chapters. It's like this perfect kind of act break so that you can take a break just like he's taking a break. There's a nice little synergy happening there.
Yeah.
This is the last call for alcohol this evening. Drink up, drink up, drink up, and order again. This is the last call for alcohol, get going.
Yeah, so I think that'll take us to kind of the end of our judgment discussion, but maybe we'll do a quick last call. We talked earlier about Studio RGG kind of having the combat focused judgment games and then the turn the action combat versus the turn based of the Like a Dragon Yakuza games. I was thinking if there was a third pillar, like obviously they're pretty busy with these two franchises, but if there was a third pillar that maybe changed up the combat or the gameplay a little bit, but still in the Yakuza universe, what do you think that type of game could be? Thoughts?
Do you mean Yakuza Dead Souls or
that experiment didn't really pan out, I don't think, right? So maybe they'll try it again with something else.
A mini game compilation party game.
yes, gotta be. So mini games, including all the classic Sega games too.
In some of the other Yakuza games, that there is I don't know about strategy, but there is some very like intense side games where they could almost be their own little passed off indie games. I'm forgetting there's one because I didn't play it, but there's one of the newer ones where you're managing some gangs, or it's like another one where you're doing like the real estate and stuff. So it's like
the real estate game.
You could just have like tiny low budget spin-offs or something based on those.
They feel like DSiWare games, or when Nintendo first started experimenting with those indie games on their digital shop, like they were in the range of like $2 to $5, something like that. It's super basic, but yeah, I like the real estate mini game personally.
And I see. I don't know, you've got action in turn-based. It's like, what else do you do if you're not just having like a completely different style of game? But I know one thing they commented on was when they, learnt that the games actually have a pretty substantial, fan or player base, was that they said, we're not going to change things to cater to them, which I think is a very smart approach, because if they already liked what it is, changing it is going to make them maybe not like it, But it does have me thinking maybe there could be not even necessarily like an unsigned game, maybe it's just like maybe side stories where you play as different characters, and you can't have one where you're like playing as a hostess and you're trying to look out for the other girls or something like that.
David, you take that if you want to go. I think I was going to talk about the same moment as you.
Yeah, there. Again, I don't want to. Like when you get there, it's a hilarious side quest thing. But there is a point in the game where you take control of a female character to become a hostess in a bar.
And
it was really good. I really enjoyed that part.
It was good because there actually was so they kind of explain what you're supposed to do and how you're supposed to respond, and then there are responses that you choose from like A, B, C, or D. And so you have to kind of choose the response that would get to the outcome that you want. But yeah, it's pretty. It was actually like a highlight of all the mini games or side things. Like that was actually one of the more fun ones.
There's a lot of management type like in various games, like where you're managing different things. And there should just be a small spin-off where you're a bar manager or something, and then occasionally you have to clear out the gangsters that start fights in your bar.
Paige, I'm gonna take a page out of your playbook here. I can't believe you didn't say dating sim. How do we not have a Studio RGG Yakuza dating sim? I mean, there's already a dating element built into these games, right? Where there are characters that you can try, you can romance and eventually go on a date with. Maybe just boil that down to like a more visual novel, pure visual novel style, where you're just going to different places in Kamurocho or somewhere else in Japan, and you're interacting with Yakuza through dialogue boxes, but also maybe forming friendships and getting into relationships that way. Like, it could be a fun third filler.
And how many of those are bad endings where you end up like locked in the back of a car or something?
they're all bad from a crime standpoint, but maybe someone wins.
I don't know. As a woman, if some of these guys are safe dating partners, I don't know.
And I'm sure there are side stories in this game where like that is a problem, right? We're one of them is dating a Yakuza.
Well, like I mentioned in the visual episode, there was like that mobile game where it's like King of Fighters for girls, and it was literally just a dating sim with King of Fighters characters.
Yes, that's right. I remember.
Yakuza for girls, and it's just dating sim with a different protagonist and main characters throughout the series.
I'll take the low hanging fruit and go with Hoshino Ace Attorney.
Yes,
where it's an Ace Attorney game, and Hoshino is the lawyer, but the investigation breaks between the trials are done by Yagami.
Yeah, I love it. That's right. He's the investigator. He's him and Kaito are the muscle. They go get the evidence for you and then bring it back to Hoshino for the courtroom.
Yeah,
it's good. I think I liked the courtroom segments. I liked the kind of movement back and forth between like Yagami going to do the detective stuff and then, you know, bringing it back. And it has like this real world kind of, it's not just all underworld Yakuza, you know, fighting and gangs and illegality. Like there's the law involved. Like there's the police presence, and they're not just kind of played for laughs. Like the police and the prosecutors are like serious characters in this game that like you have interactions with, and you have to kind of negotiate or deal with them as well. Right. So Yagami kind of being like in the middle of all these different groups, I think made him a really interesting protagonist. It's not just like Yakuza versus everybody else. It was Yagami kind of like trying to negotiate his way. And he's got friends kind of in all the places, you know, and that was kind of cool that you have allies and enemies on all sides of you. And you're constantly kind of trying to figure out like who is actually on your side or who is going to help you next or hurt you next. Pretty good. I think that'll take us to the end here. Just over an hour discussion of Judgment here with Paige and David. Looking forward to hopefully checking out Lost Judgment soon. Anything we're working on right now, Paige? Anything to plug? What's going on with you?
So my Coromon review is finally up on RPG site, and I've got a couple of videos that I'm going to be working on like today and tomorrow. So there should actually be some new videos on my YouTube channel, which is Paige G Guy, by the time this comes up.
Very good. David, what about yourself?
Mostly just concentrating on game playing for the podcast. So I think you'd mentioned we should finally get going on Nier Replicant.
That's really been sitting
on the backlog for too long. Mm-hmm. I remember that being like a Christmas gift, and now it's, you know, 6 months past. So, you know, and now that I've been tricked into playing my Xbox, it's time to play a PS5 game. So,
I don't know if I mentioned, I actually bought a Series S. it's still in the bag. I haven't opened it or anything like that. Yeah, so I can finally join the Xbox train. And if we see something there or something cool gets announced for Game Pass on Sunday, I guess is when the Xbox presentation is, I'll be able to hop in for that. Yeah, I traded in a bunch of games at EB. There's a decent promo. So I ended up getting it for less than half off or something like that. So it was pretty good. We'll be able to talk about some Xbox games, some smaller stuff there. Maybe we can do some Game Pass diving next week and try to find something there we can play too. I've got a review of Lost Ruins. It's a kind of Metroidvania with more survival elements. It's published by Dangan Entertainment. I've played and enjoyed a lot of their stuff. Really cool pixel art, some really neat lighting effects too. It released on Monday, June 6th, so kind of shadow dropped out of nowhere. I guess Dangan had a little presentation that they did with some of their upcoming games, and they dropped Lost Ruins. So I reviewed that. My review's finished. It'll be published soon, so check NWR. Hopefully going to have a video and written review for Lost Ruins coming soon. But check the website or I'll check me on Twitter. I'll post a link to it as well at Riskman64. But yeah, I think that'll take us to the end here. Thanks everybody for listening to our episode about Judgment. We finally got to it. Hopefully next week we're going to be talking about Stranger Things, actually. So we got a little bit of a departure from the gaming side. We're going to talk about part one of season four of Stranger Things. I think that's right. I think Casey might join us as well. So stay tuned for that next week, and we'll talk to everybody then. Have a good night.